Welcome to church this morning. It's wonderful to have you. I'm Pastor Sean. This is my wife, Amy.
Hi, everyone. I'm Minister of Pastoral Care. Is my mic on now? Yes, fantastic. Our West G Christmas fundraiser is starting. We are raising money this year for the Drop Zone. That is at the community center. It's a family program that runs every week, and it's great, and we want to support it. So we are selling these fancy, shiny, stainless steel travel mugs. They are $20 each, and they have our West Guilford Baptist Church logo on them. So if you're interested in supporting the Drop Zone and or would just like one of these for yourself or a gift, then they are for sale right now.
So it's just another creative way we're trying to support some of the service organizations in our area. Another creative way we're trying to support ministries abroad is through Operation Christmas Child. Just a reminder, we have some of the boxes have been returned here. Next week is Blessing Sunday for the box here at our church. If you're not able to make it, have it in by next week, you can drop it off to Lakeside November 14th or November 19th.
Starting tomorrow, our office hours are changing slightly. Rather than 9 to 5, it's going to be 9:30 to 5:30. We are just accommodating some whatever. 9:30 to 5:30. So that's Monday and Friday at the church office.
All right, I'm going to invite the worship team to come up. And some Sundays, when it's not hunting season, we are very full. And so we're trying to do some creative things in order to answer the opportunity of having a very full church a lot of the time. And so we actually have an overflow set up downstairs. It has the video playing there. There's a coffee station down there. We're slowly but surely trying to get things ready. Our nursery is under construction, I guess, or planning and / construction right now. So we're slowly but surely, but we have it set up. Betty and Neil, thank you so much. Got the TV set up there, so the service is piped down there with sound. And if you just want to have a coffee with someone after the service, there's a great spot to sit down there. We have some of these nice new comfy chairs. Let's come before the Lord with prayer. Holy Father, we just open ourselves to you at this time. We open our hearts, Lord God, and ask that you would grip us in the control center of our being, that place that the Bible talks about being our hearts, Lord God, that you would guide us and orient us towards you and towards who you are and the beauty that you have for all your people and all your creation, Lord God. We love you, and we ask that you'd give us hearts full of praise. Our call to worship is from 1 Chronicles. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come before him. Worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness. Let's stand together and worship God.
Amen.
Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing my great redeemer. Triumphs of his grace. My gracious master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth above the honors of thy name. Jesus, the name that charms our fears, that bids our sorrows cease. Tis music in the sinner's ears, tis life and health and peace. He breaks the power of canceled sin, he sets the prisoners free. His blood can make the foulest clean, his blood availed for me. Hear him, ye deaf, his praise ye dumb, your loosened tongues implore. Ye blind, behold your Savior come, and lead ye lame for joy. Glory to God and praise and love, ye ever, ever give. I saints below and saints above, church in earth and heaven. Amen. see the King of glory coming on the clouds with fire. The whole earth shakes, the whole earth shakes. I see his love and mercy washing over all our sin. The people sing, the people sing. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. I see a generation rising up to take their place with selfless faith, with selfless faith. I see a near revival stirring as we pray and seek. We're on our knees, we're on.
A seat, and we'll call Pastor Brian on up to do some prayer time with us.
Good morning, church. Boy, you can do better than that. Good morning, church. Hey, there we go. We got some smiles and everything. Well, I've been asked to lead in the prayer time today, and occasionally you've probably noticed we have an emphasis on a certain area. And so I've been asked to lead in the area of youth ministry in Haliburton County. And I want to point out that there's a big event coming up with Youth Unlimited, which used to be Youth for Christ, but the name has changed. But their ministry is still to equip and reach out to the youth in our community. And Billy Graham was the founder of Youth for Christ. I don't know how many of you knew that. Many, many years ago, he was their first worker, youth worker, and I think he did a pretty good job, from most of us think. Is this working, by the way? Yeah, it is, eh? Okay. So Youth Unlimited has really, this fall, taken a big step of faith forward. I have to immediately say I have a prejudice towards their work, because my daughter Leanne and my son-in-law Kyle are the two youth workers with Youth Unlimited. So they've gone from one youth worker to two youth workers this fall. And God has opened a way for them to have a center, a youth center, and they're calling it The Bridge, to reach out to youth in a place where youth can come, feel comfortable and feel relaxed and have good open conversations with trained volunteers. So they have the center, and it's at 2 Victoria Street. It's right beside, a lot of people seem to know where the laundromat is, right beside the laundromat, right beside the river. So they're in between, the river's over to the right. And it's not a big center, but it can hold up to 30 youth, and they've already had a few events in there. But this event, the fundraising concert, is really going to be launching their fall ministry. So it's Saturday, November 9th. Doors open at 1, concert begins at 2 p.m., some really good musical people to inspire you and encourage you. The cost is $20 per person, $50 per family, and all of it goes towards the youth center, or raising the funds to be able to reach out to youth in our area. I'm excited because this is not a new youth ministry that has no connections to our youth. Leanne was the youth worker at Lakeside up until the summertime, and they are going to be calling another youth worker, but they have volunteers still that are walking in close conjunction with them, doing things together. Matter of fact, there are 20 youth that we're going to pray for this weekend that are down in Ottawa at the Change Conference, 20 youth and 6 sponsors, and Kyle is down there, as well as several sponsors from Lakeside, and it's a weekend together with youth of worship and teaching, and it seems every year there are many kids who give their life to Christ or make a recommitment to Christ, and so they're very excited about what's happening down there, and they're working together in conjunction. So I know many of us worry about the next generation, what's going to happen to our youth, you know, are they going to go on for the Lord, and certainly the more outreach and ministry we can have to our youth, the more opportunity for them to make commitments and to be involved and to grow in their faith. So I'd like us to pray for them, that's our youth emphasis, as well as pray for this event that's coming up, as well as other things that God has put on our heart. So please join me together as we come to the Lord together in prayer. Father God, your word says, be still and know that I am God. In the stillness, we sense that you are not only good and faithful, but that you are continuing to move by your Spirit. And we praise you and we thank you for that. Thank you that you are always working. Your word says that. Jesus, you said, my Father in heaven is always moving, always working. And I come alongside and I do what the Father wants me to do. And that's what you want us to do, to come alongside what you are doing and to be involved with our prayers and with our actions, with our lives. We see you moving in our county amongst our youth, Lord. We praise you that they were Youth Unlimited were able to rent a facility on a 3-year lease by faith. They signed that. Place for youth to be able to come and drop in and to find a quiet place, a fun place, a place that they could just feel safe. We also know you want for them to develop relationships with other youth, Christian youth, and a place where they can meet adults who care, who can listen to them, and with a listening heart, a caring heart, maybe pray for them. Maybe share the love of Christ with them. We thank you, Father, that you've raised up this building and this fall a new emphasis for Youth Unlimited. And for those who can make it on Saturday, they will hear all about that. They will see pictures of the new youth center. They will hear what's happened, what is going to happen, what they are walking in faith with. And they will have an opportunity to pray for them and to be led by you, Holy Spirit, towards how we want to individually and as a community work with them to reach out to our youth. So we thank you, Father. We pray for Leanne and Kyle, for the 10 youth sponsors that they've raised up and trained already. Thank you for that. We thank you for the partnership with Lakeside Church and their youth and their youth sponsors. I think they're the only two Christian youth organizations in our whole county that are really reaching out to youth. So, Father, we pray that you may just do a mighty work. Holy Spirit, blow through and provide for their needs and open the doors for ministry. And, Father, we just thank you that for such a time as this, you are doing these things. We thank you, Father, too, that you know there are 20 young people, apparently over 1,000 young people in total in Ottawa at this Change Conference. This morning is the last message. It will be the message where the gospel is clearly presented. We pray that, Father, they may have ears to hear, that Holy Spirit, you will have already touched their heart through the worship and the messages, and that today when they get a chance to commit their lives to Christ, that some, and we pray by faith that many, who need to get real with you and get more serious with you will come to that place. Commitments, recommitments, we put that in your hands, Lord. We thank you for the opportunity of so many of our youth being able to join with them. We thank you, Father, too, that you know that our schools are places where we need you to be present through the Christian teachers, staff, Father, through the Christian students. We pray for them, Father. We pray that your spirit may work there, Father. We thank you that Kyle is already in the high school one day a week mingling with the youth, and that Leanne, starting in January, will be into JDH doing the same thing. Praise you, Father, for that. We pray for protection, Father, for the teachers and the EAs and for the principals and vice principals and for all the staff there. Pray for our children who attend, Father. We know that there are some agendas that we don't perhaps agree with, or maybe we're very much against. And Father, being negative will not cause things to change, but prayer may. And so we need to be people of prayer. We thank you, Lord, that you are good every day to us. And we take for granted so many times the daily blessings that you bestow upon us, the provisions that we overlook and we don't say thank you for. Father, we want to thank you for things like clean air that we breathe here in Haliburton County, water and food, heated homes, Father. We live in a country that is so free in a good way, Canada, and maybe one of the best countries in the world. And we don't thank you enough. Those of us who live up here, we're surrounded with the beauty of your creation. And sometimes we take it for granted. So, Father, may we say in our spirits today, thank you, Lord. Thank you for all your provisions, for your everyday blessings. Father, we pray today for the world we live in. And for many of us, it's hard for us to be encouraged by what's going on in the world because it seems so negative, so full of conflict. But we need to trust that you are working things out for a big picture plan, that we can't see the end, but we know in your word says that you win. You will win through everything that is happening, even through the wars that are going on, Israel and Gaza and other
countries now that are maybe getting involved, Father, through Ukraine and Russia, that you will win. You will bring about a good result if we keep faithful, keep praying. We pray for the people. We pray for those especially who seem to be the innocent bystanders and caught in those conflicts. We pray for Haiti, a country that is so poor that we can't even imagine what it's like to live so full of drug lords and things like that. But Father, you can bring good even from evil, and we put that in your hands. Some of us think that maybe there's a need for praying for a miracle with this U.S. election coming up. And you know my heart, Lord, I'm not a political creature in any way. I don't know who you want to win and who you want to raise up and lay aside. I don't know. But I trust you. My eyes are on you. And our trust needs to be in the one who created this world, the one who raises up leaders and tears down leaders, not in the leaders themselves. They're all fragile. They're all broken. They're all frail. But you can use whoever you raise up. And so may we believe that in our hearts and pray, Father, that people will get out and vote. They have the freedom to do that. And we leave the results in your hands. Whoever is elected, you have told us to pray for our leaders, not to necessarily just criticize them, though sometimes it's hard not to, but we put them in your hands. And we pray for our leaders in Canada, Father, for our Prime Minister, Justin Trudeau, for Doug Ford, our Premier, for the other premiers in the other provinces. Father, use them. Thank you again for the freedom that we have to elect them and give them wisdom and guidance in leading those that you've put under them, Father. We thank you for this church. We thank you for what you've done here over 100 years. We thank you for the phase we're in right now, a growth phase. We thank you for Pastor Sean and Amy and for our elders. And Father, may you give them great guidance and wisdom. I know they seek after you on a regular basis. Help them to find balance in their own lives, especially Pastor Sean and Amy, raising 4 kids. Help them, Father. And thank you that this fall you've raised up a marriage course that 30 people went to the first meeting. Praise you, Father, for that. May they all find something that can help in their relationships to make them stronger, Father, by going there. And Father, we pray for the sick amongst us. You know that there are perhaps many that are away with colds or flus or whatever they may be away with, as well as some are gone hunting. And we pray for protection for them. But we pray, Father, for Lee Doucette specifically and Joan Robertson, as we've been asked to, as they are not well. We ask that you may help them to get well again. We pray for our shut-ins, those who would like to be here but can't be, Father, and you know each one by name. May your grace be sufficient. We love you, Lord, and we thank you for this time together in prayer. In Jesus' wonderful name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Let's stand together for one more song before the kids head down.
He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise him, he is exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise.
Down for Kids Church. I think we're following Miss Deb this morning.
So we're going to be in Romans chapter 10, starting at the 16th verse this morning. Some of you know that during my time in the military as an officer, I really loved to teach on basic training. And one of the aims of basic training in the Army was to get one of the things I loved about basic training is one of our aims was to get the students to understand that they were capable of far more than they could imagine. They're capable of far more than anything they ever did in the civilian world. And so we really pressed, especially for the first few weeks of basic training, a boot camp, they will press you in certain ways. For instance, staff will often sleep deprive students in a controlled setting, right? The controlled setting, they're not going to sleep deprive you if you're going to be live firing, right? But if you're going to be in the classroom, staff will oftentimes sleep deprive you so that you can see when push comes to shove, you can work longer than you had thought, right? We'll make you, for me, I was afraid of heights. One of the things they did is they had us jumping from helicopter skids and stuff like that, like just to make you, to break you from the idea that you can't do and to get you to believe that you can do. I used to teach, I was a specialist in a number of different ways. Some of it was operational planning for NATO. And I used to teach on the basic training. I wouldn't be there at the beginning of the course. I would be there later on when they started to learn more advanced stuff. And so when I arrived, it was later in the training, and it was not uncommon while I was teaching at the front of a classroom for students to actually stand up and go stand at the back of the classroom while I was teaching. And the reason they did that is they've been taught, if you're falling asleep in your chair, you do not fall asleep when a senior officer's talking, right? So they would stand up, and they'd go stand, and they'd stand at the back. And some guys stood there, some men and women, they'd stand there for half an hour to make sure they didn't fall asleep, right? Because they were being shown that they could accomplish far more than they thought if they had different strategies to do that. Because if you think you can't do something, you will be right 100% of the time. The story, friends, you tell yourself matters. What you tell yourself in your heart, what you tell yourself in your mind, it matters for how you see yourself, and it matters for how you walk in the world. It matters for what you're going to accomplish. As we continue our series in the book of Romans, this is the reality we're going to explore with the Apostle Paul. Our big idea is this: the story you tell yourself matters. So tell yourself God's big story. It's God's big story of what he's done and what he's done in you that leads to new life. And it's the world's story about who you are that leads to death. That's our choice this morning. So if you'll turn with me to Romans chapter 10, starting at the 16th verse, and let's pray together. Holy Father, as I open up your word this morning, I really just pray that the gospel would get through. I pray, Lord God, that you would change hearts and minds and that only the truth would be spoken and only the truth would be heard. And as always, Lord, if there's anything of Sean that's not of God, that's not of Jesus or the Holy Spirit, that would just flutter away. And the only things that would land in our minds and in our hearts are your gospel truth. In your name we pray. Amen. So I'm going to read from Romans chapter 10 when I have my glasses. All right. Starting at the 16th verse, I'm reading from the ESV. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed what he has heard from us? So faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. But I ask, have they not heard? Indeed they have, for their voice has gone out to all the earth and words to the ends of the world. But I ask, did Israel not understand? First, Moses says, I will make you jealous of those who are not a nation. With a foolish nation, I will make you angry. Then Isaiah is also bold as to say, I have been found by those who did not seek me.
I have shown myself to those who did not ask for me. But of Israel, he says, all day long I have held out my hands to a disobedient and contrary people. May God bless us by the reading of his word. So it obviously, the passage I just read, picks up immediately from somewhere. And where it picks up is what we talked about last week. Paul has just laid out the simple truth of the gospel. The simple truth of what God has done. We call the good news what God has done in Jesus and what he's done within us through Jesus. So Paul has just explained that. And now he turns to how Israel could miss the good news. How is it that Israel missed the good news? Because they didn't listen, Paul is saying, to the story God was telling all the way through their history, right? Over and over again, for in chapter 8 and chapter 9, he's pulled from the prophets just to show God has been telling you what the Messiah was going to look like. God has been telling you what the world's going to look like after the Messiah. But they weren't listening to God's story. They weren't paying attention to God's story. They were telling their own story. By the end of the Old Covenant, when the Messiah finally came, we're going to have the, you know, country Christmas is coming, right? We're going to celebrate when Jesus came, because that was a pivotal moment in the universe. That is when the Old Covenant ended and the New Covenant started to dawn. And when the Messiah finally came, Israel had two stories that were competing for their hearts. First, they had the story God was telling through them. But then they had the story they were telling themselves, right? So Israel has two stories going on when Jesus comes. The story God's telling, the story they're telling themselves. The first story, God's story, is revealed in his word. And Paul is taking great aims to show this was revealed from the beginning. It's not something that was new that came with Jesus. God, what God revealed and what God's story was, is he took this particular ancient tribe, right? An ancient tribe literally from the middle of nowhere. Even in the ancient times, Israel was the middle of nowhere. So he took this tribe out with the Springboks in the middle of nowhere, right? And he carved them apart. He set them apart as his own. And then he led them through history as his people to the new kingdom of the promised Messiah and the new life found through the Holy Spirit. That was the story God was telling. God's story is about showing who he is. God's story is about sharing his love, his nature, his glory with his rebellious creation. God's story, friends, is about God. But Israel's story was about them. It was about how great they were in contrast to everybody else, every other race or nation. It was how smart and holy they were, so great that they believed they had achieved righteousness in God's eyes through their religion. So there were two stories that Israel had when Jesus came. There was the true story that God was telling, and there was the false story that Israel was telling themselves. And in our passage, Paul is highlighting the fact that Israel, by and large, was not living God's story, so that's why they didn't hear, that's why they didn't recognize the Messiah when he came, because they were living a lie. They were living a lie about God, and they were living a lie about themselves, a lie that caused them to miss out on Jesus and on the glory that God had for them. And as we unpack this short section, though, I want us to recognize this is not primarily about Israel. This is also about us, because I want us to start thinking about the stories we tell ourselves that aren't true. The stories we tell ourselves about the universe, about our culture, about our own state of our own souls that are contrary to what God tells us about the universe and about us. Because one leads to life and one leads to death. Because as with the Israelites, God through Jesus is very clear about what he's doing, right? It isn't a secret. What God was doing back in Israel's time was not a secret to his people, as it says in verse 16, but they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed what he has heard from us? So Isaiah is even saying, in this kind of complex Hebrew way, they're not going to believe what it is that I'm saying. He knew that Israel wasn't going to believe it. And I want us to remember, Paul, when he says this, was a teacher of Israel.
Paul was a leader in Jerusalem. He was a persecutor of Christians, right? He was right on the edge of being on the council before God gripped his heart and his eyes were open to the truth of what God was doing. So when he talks about Israel, Paul isn't just talking about Israel. He's talking about his own experience because he had failed to believe the Messiah. He was in Jerusalem when Jesus was there. And just like his people, by and large, they failed to believe their Messiah. And their failure to believe was a failure to accept what God was doing, because God was clear about what he was doing. And it's those who truly hear, it's those who truly understand in their hearts, those are the ones who have faith. As it says in verse 17, so faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. Now, when Paul says hearing here, take us to our next slide. When Paul says hearing here, it's not just any kind of hearing, but it is hearing through the word of Christ. There is a spiritual hearing that we are given through the Holy Spirit, which allows us to hear what God is saying, hear God's story over the world's story, and even over the story that we tell ourselves. Because oftentimes, it's not the world that's oppressing us. Our own hearts are oppressing us and whispering lies to us. Those things that keep you up at night. 3 o'clock in the morning is when it hits me, right? Across the Bible, the ability to truly hear God is an important aspect of our spiritual growth, is an important aspect of our formation. One of the abiding images of Jesus is the Good Shepherd. Amy and I, the church we went to before the military was called the Parish of the Good Shepherd, right? It's just a very famous, even those who don't know the Lord understand. We say the Good Shepherd, a lot of folks will know you're talking about Jesus. It comes out of chapter 10 of the Gospel of John, when Jesus says, he uses the image of the shepherd to describe himself, says, I am the Good Shepherd. The Good Shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Now, on top of sacrifice and protection, the point Jesus was also making when it came to him being a good shepherd was about the sheep's ability to hear. It was about this spiritual hearing that we see throughout the Bible. A spiritual kind of hearing he's talking about that recognizes who to listen to and recognizes who to follow. John 10:7-8, so Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. Those who have been renewed by the Holy Spirit discern between the voices of the world and the voices of the Good Shepherd who loves us. The ones who will lead to destruction and the one who will tend to us, maybe shear us when it comes time, but by and large will protect us and love us. Every person hears on one level, right? We all hear the voices outside and inside that whispered those alternate choices. As followers of Jesus, though, we've been given new hearing, a spiritual gift in that to hear in a way that recognizes and that focuses on the truth and the story that God is telling. The word, which Jesus says, brings life. John 10:14-16. I am the good shepherd. I know my own and they know me. Just as a father knows me and I know the father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And I have sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also. They will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock and one shepherd. That other sheep, those are us. Now, there might be a few ethnic Jewish people here. I don't know. But by and large, we are that other flock. We are that other fold that he's brought in. The life of faith, friends, of walking with the living God involves hearing him and hearing his story and what his story tells you about yourself. Because in the day-to-day of modern life, the gospel can go over our heads because we're busy listening with other things. This is a reality for us, and it was a reality for Israel. Verse 18, we're returning to Paul's passage, or the passage from Romans 10. But I ask, have they not heard? Indeed they have, for their voice has gone out to all the world, and their words to the ends of the world. So they heard, but they didn't really hear. The Turner family are a family of gamers. We love video games. We have VRs, we have
We're not PlayStation people, we're Xbox people. We have PCs all over the place. Amy actually had a gaming YouTube channel at one point where people would watch her stream. She was actually, they really loved it. When she stopped doing it, we got messages saying, why aren't you doing this anymore? But so we're big into games. It's one of the kind of one of our hobbies. Now, for those who've raised teenagers, what happens when you try to talk to someone who's in the middle of an intense part of their video game? Right? They will hear you, but they aren't really hearing you. They're not internalizing. In some cases, they will just make up what you said, right? It's amazing how quickly do the dishes becomes you don't have to do the dishes. I'm glad my mom's not here because she would have just lost it. That's what it was like trying to tell me to do things, right? That's what happened with Israel. They were hearing, but they weren't hearing. They were so caught up in their time that they started to change God's story to suit their time. The alternate story that Israel was telling was so powerful, they wrote it down as what it was called their traditions. They wrote it down as their teachings, and then they set it up beside the Word of God. And in fact, they only read the Word of God through their story. Like they filtered through their teachings and the lessons, the traditions that they had. That's how they would understand the Word of God. And they filtered everything from God's Word through the lie that they were telling themselves. They were told, but they didn't understand. They were too caught up in what was going on in front of them. Or they refused to understand and struggled when God opened up His grace to all people, as it says in verses 19 and 20, and became entrenched in disobedience. Like this is what Paul's talking about here. He's talking about entrenchment in disobedience, rooted in a lie that they were telling themselves. But as throughout Romans, again, this is not about Israel. For us, it's about us. And this matters because we do the same thing. We measure God's truth by whatever this week's opinion happens to be in the world. How quickly do the opinions change in our world this day, today? Right? Depending on what's trending, it's just like that. We trade God's big story for the one that suits us in the moment. And in doing that, we move away from our identity in Him. And moving away from our identity in Jesus leads to a multitude of spiritual, mental, and psychological issues, the answer to which, I believe, is returning to God's story, to what He's done in Jesus and who we are as a result. Spiritual maturity and health means being so steeped in God's story that we live out of the identity that He gives us, and we live out of what He's done. So Paul says, faith comes through hearing. Friends, faith comes through hearing. Our faith also grows through hearing. The more we internalize God's story, the more we get our identity from Him. So we lean into what the Lord is saying, and we lean away from what the world is saying. It means we stop focusing ourselves and telling ourselves false stories about who we are, and we focus on Jesus. And there are several stories. My time in counseling, folks, there are several false lies that we love to tell ourselves, right? These thinking errors that we have. They are both ungodly and they're unhealthy. And it's the gospel that counters these false narratives. I could go through a ton of examples. I'm just going to give a few here. One I'm going to focus in on particular. One example is maybe your internal story is that because you don't fit the world's mold of the perfect person, right? There's a bullseye. But because I don't fit the bullseye in our world, there's something wrong with me. There's something inherently wrong with me because I'm not fitting what the world says I should be. I'm too sensitive, or I'm too opinionated. I'm too loud, or I'm too quiet. I'm too funny. I'm not funny enough. I'm not funny in the right way, right? There are a million ways that we don't hit the bullseye of what the world says today we need to be. This is a huge problem for young people who have been raised in an age of digital, of social media, where every hour, you know, the target changes every hour. And on top of that, everybody else seems so perfect online. All their friends seem so perfect online. That is the false story the world tells. It's unhealthy, and it's a lie. It's very easy to tell ourselves there's something wrong with us because we don't feel like we fit in. But the gospel tells us a different story. The gospel's honest. There is something inherently wrong with us and with the world. But the good news, there's good news in the gospel. It says Jesus heals us of that. and he continually grows us into his image, which, by the way, his image is inherently countercultural. We will not fit in with the world. Not fitting in with the world is a defining characteristic of God's big story of being a Christian. So if that is you, if you're believing there's something inherently wrong with you because you're not really fitting in with the world, you need to preach to yourself God's truth. Things like 1 Peter 2:24, he himself bore our sins on his body on the tree that he might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds we have been healed. You are a new creation. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and who gave himself for me. Galatians 2:20. Knowing your Bible is not about knowing how to having ammunition to argue on the internet. Knowing your Bible isn't really even primarily about getting ethical rules for living. Knowing your Bible is about understanding who you are. It's about understanding in God's big story who he's made you into be. And having knowledge of the truth that counters those lies that we tell ourselves. Like there's something inherently wrong with me. Or these sibling lies that we have. Others have it all together online, but I don't. Or the false stories that go on and on. If I have X, I will finally be happy. If I could only afford to do Y, then I would be happy. Or for those who are really, really suffering, who say, I'm not worth it. Jesus says you are worth it. He paid and he died for you. So the story, God's big story, counters the lies. So friends, I really don't buy into the unhealthiness, the spiritual sickness of the world. Lean into the health that Jesus has for you. That's our call this morning. I've learned through many years of ministry, so many mental health issues have a spiritual root in ungodly beliefs about ourselves. When you come to faith in Jesus, the Bible says you repent. That's not only saying, I'm sorry, that I turn from that story the world's telling towards the story God tells me about myself. I'm plucked out of the false story of the world, and I'm placed in the reality that Jesus puts me in, where through Jesus I am loved eternally, and I'm given a new royal identity and set on the path that leads to life. 1 Peter 2:9, another great passage to preach to yourself. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. So that is our call this week. I want you to pay attention to the story you're telling yourself. And I want you to replace any false stories, any unhealthy stories, with the story God tells you about yourself. Because the story you tell yourself matters. So I want you to preach to yourself this week. I want you to set up a pulpit in your heart, and I want you to preach the good news of who you are in Jesus. Amen? All right, I'm going to invite the worship team to come up. And as they do, I'm going to ask the ushers if they'll please go down and get the kids. Now, if this is really hitting home for you, what you might want to do this week is look in, just go to Google and look up what's called the identity statements of the New Testament. Who the New Testament says you are now in Jesus. If you Google that, those are the things you want to preach, you want to maybe memorize, or you just want to focus on every day this week to start leaning into God's story in those healthy narratives that Jesus tells you about who you are, who he bought, that life that he bought for you. Let's pray together. Holy Father, I just pray that you would help us to lean into our identity in you. I pray, Lord God, for all those in this room and beyond in our congregation who are suffering under the weight of lies that the world's been telling them, Lord. I pray that you would break through the lies with the word of life and that we would learn to lean in to this glorious, loving eternity that you have for us that we can live even now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand together. Hallelujah. a seat, everyone.
Hello. So we've come to the end of our time together, and once a month we try to come to it and do what Jesus told his disciples to do, to remember about him. There's a lot to remember. The story is a big story. We have a big God and a big Savior in Jesus. But he told one specific part for them to remember. He said, do this in remembrance of me. And he was pointing them towards an event that had not happened yet. Imagine, think of that. It hadn't happened yet, but he was pointing them that when this event happens, remember who you are in me and why I came to this earth. I came to show you the love of the Father. I came to show you my love. I came to encourage you to live for him, but I also came to save you from your sins. I came purposely to go to the cross, to die on that cross for your sins, to have my body broken and my blood shed for you. They must have been in a bit of a daze. I could see them looking around at each other and, what is he talking about? Because they were on the other side of the cross. But by the grace and mercy of God, we live on this side of the cross. He has not only saved us, he has revealed himself to us. He has chosen us. We do not choose to follow him. He chooses to call us to himself. Goodness and grace and mercy of God. Because we are not worthy on our own. He makes us worthy. Last week, Pastor Sean talked about he clothes us in his righteousness. Wow. What a God we serve. So we're going to have communion together. Some congregations call it the Lord's table, but it's a chance for us to come together and take elements that remind us of what he has done for us. In our case, we've gone to these little plastic emblems that have, under the first layer, they have a little wafer that is symbolic of the body of Christ that was broken for us. And then under that layer is some juice that represents the blood of Christ that was shed for us to take away our sins. Without the shedding of blood, the Bible says, there is no remission of sin. There is no forgiveness for sin. He paid for our sins on the cross. Not for his sins, but for our sins. The Word of God says this in 1 Corinthians 11. This is what Jesus said to his disciples on that first Lord's table. Using my poppy. He said this. Or this is what the Word of God says in 1 Corinthians 11. For I received from the Lord what I have passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. We're going to give thanks for the body of Christ that is broken for us. I'm going to ask Gary, if he would give thanks for the body that is broken for us.
Heavenly Father, what a privilege it is to be able to come here today to partake in this communion service and remember your body that was broken on our behalf, Lord. And we thank you for that. Lord, we just pray that you give us the wisdom and gift to be able to be light to others in this world, especially this time of the year when the seasons, their daylight gets short, Help us to be lights so people can look and see something in us that they need. It's you, Lord. Just pray you give us the wisdom and guidance to do that. I thank you, Jesus, for your dying on the cross for us. Amen.
We take the wafer, and together, as a sign of the unity, the oneness we have in Christ, let us remember what Jesus did for us on the cross. Where God says, in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he returns." I'm going to ask Brother Neil if he would give thanks for the blood of Christ.
Eternal God, loving Father, your word says you demonstrated your love towards us and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. We acknowledge, Father, that it's because of the cross work of Christ that we are able to stand accepted. We are accepted in the place that only Christ could claim for us. His precious blood was shed on the cross to pay for our sin. May the truth of this just be indelibly imprinted upon us, Lord, and may we want to please you with our lives because of all that we have been blessed with in Christ and who we are in Christ. So we remember him in his own appointed way. And as he said, do this in remembrance of me until I come again. In his worthy name we pray. Amen.
So together, bought by the blood of Christ, may we remember what he has done for us.
Our closing hymn is How Deep the Father's Love for Us. Let's stand together and sing.